Hello, Dungeon fans. Welcome to the Liching Hour. I'm your host, The Lich, and tonight we've got something a little special. In fact, Echo, that's what we've got. There. Tonight we've got our first episode of Dungeon Crawl Classics X-Crawl. X-Crawl stands for Extreme Dungeon Crawling. Imagine this, a fantasy world, that over centuries evolves and builds up some form of tech to the point where they're by 80% us, where they've got cities, they got automobiles, you know, all that kind of thing. Maybe they don't have the internet, that stuff. And their big sports kind of events is full auditorium, huge stadium, dungeon crawling. You're sitting in the stands, you're watching a group of adventurers go through a dungeon, and if they die, they die, right? They're fighting monsters, they're overcoming traps. You're watching them do that. Tonight, we're watching a group of, we're playing a group of six first level characters going into a dungeon, and we're going to see what happens. All held at the, in Brooklyn, at the Academy of Letters Athletic Complex. This tonight is called Dungeon Battle Brooklyn. Let's get going. This is my first time too, so we're going to try this out. I'm going to narrate most of it. If you want to join in and speak up in chat, if you want to make any kind of help on the calls and the things that are going on, I'd love to work it into the story. If you follow me and let me know, you can pick one of the contestants and we will like make sure that they don't die at some point. You kind of buy them a safety net. Let's go. Let's do this. So the story here is that in order to drum up some support and some kind of local support for this particular dungeon crawl, they put out a contest, like a contest for dungeon masters. They call them dungeon jockeys to build, submit dungeon ideas. And the winner was picked. It was a Brooklyn native, young kid. We tune in now as he takes the stage. Okay, crawlers, he's addressing the stadium. Get ready. This is my very first dungeon, so I hope it's fun and everything. Your performance is being evaluated by a special judging panel of the Adventurers Guild. They will choose a winner based on heroism, skill, leadership, and of course, how far you get with how many players intact. Not to make you, nervous or anything. So get ready. I may be young, but I haven't pulled any punches yet. Yesterday I saw First Blood. So your quest is to defeat all monsters, find the three sections of a scroll, and read it aloud to access the last and final room. I have to go backstage now and get a few surprises ready for you. Ha ha. Yeah. Well, there you have it, folks. The young DJ Seymour Blood in his first dungeon. And now we see the contestants are being ushered out into the auditorium. Yeah, crowd's going nuts. You're probably going nuts too, right? We have six contestants. Let's meet the contestants. Well, look at that big one there. Yeah, that's Hank Ajax Tybalt. He's a warrior, obviously. Look at him. He was born to do this. We're looking forward to seeing what he can pull off. Then standing next to him is the blonde elf is Tina Supernova Gosling. She's a student, it says here, she's a student in Harvard Arcana and looking to win her way through college. Then standing kind of slightly beside her, like he's about to be hiding in the shadows as quick as possible, is Zaster Forster Stillstar. He's made a name for himself in the Funnel League, but this is his first time in the bigs. Then the guy in the robe over there, Richard Mayday Hayden. He's a wizard. We don't know much about him, but we don't know much about wizards now, do we? Mysterious fellows. The short guy right next to him, the little guy, Ruskell the Carnivore. We don't know a lot about him, but we're going to find out, or I'll tell you more at the break. And finally, Shalia, the large lady there. Shalia Sunburn Steelwagon, cleric for Apollo. Not much to say about her except that she wants everyone to embrace the Golden Archer. So there we have it. Those are our six contestants. Looks like their first room. Now, if you take a look around the auditorium, there's no ceiling to this dungeon. The players are in a dungeon. There's plexiglass walls and big oak doors, and they've got to go room from room to room. We, of course, can see everything. And as you can see, we can see a little bit ahead. We see a room full of orcs. We see a big sandy room that doesn't seem to have anything in it, which is a little odd. We see over there, a little further away, is a labyrinth of some sort. And then, is there ninjas in that one room? We don't know, but it's pretty exciting. We're gonna see what's gonna happen. This first room looks like they turned the auditorium of the school into something special, like an obstacle course. Let's see here. It's thick orange arrows painted on hardwood floors lead the characters to around these different obstacles. Everything from a swing ropes, attack barriers, and stuff like that. In the center of the room's a big tower with two guys manning some kind of gun, which isn't pointed at the contestants just yet. And then just past that, it looks like a huge mechanical ogre of some sort. So we're gonna see what's gonna happen. Oh, looks like the referees are gonna start speaking now. Whistle goes out. You have to hit all four buttons, then assault the tower to win this room. Follow the arrows. Don't skip any obstacles. And follow the instructions of your referee. On my mark, get ready, set, go. No, we're off. Okay, so here we go. Hank Ajax Tibble, being the natural born athlete that he looks to be, he takes off first, of course. That looks like the first challenge is going to be swinging across the mud. Tibble. Or we're gonna just start calling him Ajax from here on out. Ajax runs up and grabs the ropes. I don't think this is gonna be a problem for him, but we gotta roll anyway. He does roll what he needs. He jumps. It looks like he starts off a little rocky, like we expected a little better from him, but he does make it pass over the mud. Next up, the elf. She does it handily. She jumps up with glorious grace. The thief. He does a little dance right before he goes. Hold the foam, folks. What's his agility? No. So, Zaster does this little dance for the crowd. Does a little like this kind of thing. And then almost falls off the rope the ropes into the mud, which makes everybody go nuts. We love that because we almost at some point he is gonna fail, and that's beautiful. Wizard's up. Oh, looks like he's about to trip over his robes. He makes it just barely, his robes dragging in the mud. Now we're up for the halfling, the carnivore. What is his story? He makes it too. Swings. Nothing too spectacular. And then coming up in the rear is the cleric. Now she's wearing a little bit of armor. So we're going to see. In fact, she should be rolling 1d16. Barely makes it. She barely gets across. Wow, if this is any indication how the rest of this is go, this might be a short night and bloody night. Looks like the next thing they got to do is run through some tires. Let's see how they do this. Hank Ajax. He's up first. He's running. Hup, 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 hup. He stumbles. Coon, coon. The big warrior falls. Hits himself in the head with a flail. We go nuts. Yes. Love to see guys fall in the mud. We jeering. We're jeering. I don't think I've ever jeered in my life. Next up, Tina, Supernova. Whoa, man, the rules. I'm gonna have to grab another dice for these people. It is not nice what's going on with this die right now. That's like the fifth five that's been rolled. Supernova is not as graceful in the tires as she was swinging from the ropes. She trips over Hank, and they both go tumbling. Boo, boo. Zaster, Forrester, Stillstar. Will he overcome? Ha! he's a show off. He jumps and leaps through each one and then jumps over them and still manages to hit the tire. Now we've got the wizard coming through. He makes it by as well. Everybody's cleared out. He does goes by, holding his robes up as he goes. Ruskell, the carnivore, the halfling. He's only about 3 foot tall, so the tires go up to here. No, they don't go up that far. Maybe his waist. So it's not too easy for him, but he manages to do it. And the cleric. Sunburn, the cleric. She stumbles over her armor and falls over. Boo, this is not looking good for this team so far. I hope their fighting skills are way better than their athleticism. Everybody gets out and hits their button. We hear a police car style siren go off in the stadium, flashing blue lights. The first button has been pushed. Let's see what happens next. They've got to run through a gauntlet of padded dummies. First up, Ajax. Will the dummy hit him as he rushes through it? Oh, yes, it does. He's a little too big. Something hits him good. One of them hits him right in the face. He's going, he's dicking, he's dodging, he's dodging. Boom! Comes up at the really wrong time. Oh, the whole crowd goes, oh, ouch! That hurt. Tina, she's coming through. Looks like she wants to do some flipping. And jumping around. Ooh, her too. She misjudges a zigzag this way and that way. Boom. She takes some damage as well. It's actually, should have been rolling this. Ah, but it just lightly grazes her. Ooh. The thief comes rolling through. Wow, these dummies roll really good. Our thief, same deal. He tries doing something a little showing off. He's trying to make up for saving the face for the tire kind of thing. He does this kind of, he did good with the tires. Yeah, he's rolling. He's feeling really confident. He goes for a roll. He misjudges the distance he's got to roll. It comes up, hits himself in the head on one of the dummies, taking himself 2 points of damage. Oh, the wizard. He's going to take it slow because he's not dumb. All right. Richard Mayday Hayden kind of just takes it slow. Doesn't take any damage. The halfling runs through. This should be easy for this guy. Totally. Halfling just runs right through it. I guess they weren't really set up for halflings. Next up, our cleric. Well, this looks like she's just going to run through them all. Ah, she looks like she's going to run through them all, but the last second each time she goes, whoo, whoo, and nothing touches her. We've made it past the attack dummies. Everybody hits their button. Second button goes off. Woo! Only two more to go. Yes. Three buttons. Now it's the arcane target range. Now that we're tracking the players, we see this kind of a referee standing there and a dummy right before the big mechanical ogre thing. It looks like the heroes have gathered up there. They're talking to each other. It looks like Mayday, the wizard, stepping up. He's taking a scroll from the referee, and he's reading it, and he's casting it. It looks like he's going to cast it at this target. Spell. You see a spell rock. We all see this spell rock out of the scroll and hit the target dummy. The target dummy goes like this, and the ogre, we hear, and the ogre kind of falls down. All right, it looks like they did some kind of something good happen there. They all start running. They look like the kind of smiles on their faces as they run by past the mechanical ogre who does nothing to them. They hit the next button. Boo-woo. Police sirens going off. They're almost three-quarters of the way done with this. Oh, my gosh. A cage falls on them. I don't even see where that came from. Did anybody else see where that came from? That came out of nowhere, folks. Trapped them in the cage. How are they going to get out of this? They're going to have to... Ajax is already trying to lift it. Looks like it's too hot, too heavy. Oh, sounds like it's time for the thief to step up and pick the lock. Let's see. Is Zaster good with picking locks? He looks like he's pretty good with it. Oh, yes, he is. Takes him just a second, blows a quick kiss to the crowd, and the guy, everybody's gotten out of the cage. And that's when the cannon starts going off. Looks like those two guys up in the tower, are shooting the cannon. It looks like they might be tennis balls at the car at the players. All right. Looks like once around they're gonna be shooting. I think it's initiative time. Because these guys are being shot at. So, let's do it. Need this. All right. These are goblins up in the tower shooting these tennis balls. They got a 15. Ajax, 18. Supernova, 10. Forrester, 12. Actually, let's add these guys' bonuses. So, by the way, anybody watching wants to know anything about the Dungeon Crawl Classics system, the role-playing game system, have any questions at all? I'm watching chat. I want to answer any questions. At its heart, it's a D20. It's based off old school D&D though. It's got a lot of so you can consider it an OSR if you're familiar with the term. It's a fun system. So that said, everybody gets some of these guys got an initiative modifier. So let's see, Ajax, he got plus two, so he's at 20 actually. Supernova's got plus two, she's at 12. Forrester's got plus two, he's at 14. Mayday's at 17, and plus two is 19. The Carnivore. He rolls a. Oh, I should be rolling over here for you guys. 19. He's got plus two. He's at 22. Or I'm sorry, 21. And then Sunburn is rolling a 15 plus nothing. So she's at 15. So she's tied with the goblins. Okay. So Halfling's going first. The characters look like they're talking really quick because it looks like they have a limited amount of options. They're gonna have to, in order to nullify this tower, they're probably gonna have to climb up there. Yeah. But it looks like Mayday, wizard, he grabs Ajax and was whispering in his ear, and then they're bringing another crowd in. What are they thinking? What's going on here? Why aren't they starting rushing up the tower? Well, Mayday doesn't have to, let's say Mayday is going at 19, so he convinces Carnivore to hold off on his initiative and Ajax, and now it's he's up. Looks like he's about to do something. Is he gonna cast a spell? Is it? It's about to get good. Oh shit, it's not Mayday though. It's Tina. Tina's got what I'm thinking. Looks like Mayday's bringing Tina over. Where's Tina? Tina is at. She's at. They're all holding off for Tina. All right, Tina is casting. It looks like she's casting a spell. She starts doing her thing. We're gonna see what actually how it. We don't know what spells she's got. We're gonna see. We're gonna find out together. Let's see what she rolls. Ooh, she rolls a four. That is four plus one. So she's gonna roll a five. Oh, that's not good. So everybody holds off. Tina goes to cast something. It looks like an eye opens up in her forehead. This bloodshot eye. Is that really that? Is that what I'm seeing right now? But then she waves her hands and nothing happens. And if she or she goes, and Mayday, the wizard goes, like that. We all go, the crowd goes, oh, what? And then suddenly, foom, 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 the goblins start shooting with the cannon and right at Tina. Goblins roll an 8, missing her. I don't think they have much of a modifier. Plus 3 attack. They roll 11. Her armor class is 12. They just barely miss her. Enough to wake her up off of her little, like, whatever happened just then. On a side note, she had failed her roll. Now she lost the spell that she was trying to cast for the day, which sucks. Actually, nope, that was way too low. On a side note, though, she can do what's called spell burn later on to cast the spell that she'd forgotten. What happens is, depending on the level of the spell, she can minus one from, because it's a level one spell, she can minus one from any one of her attributes for the day. So she can shave off some of her strength in order to recast that spell. What spell, you ask? We'll have to find out. We'll have to find out later. All right. Looks like it looks like the halfling has taken matters into his own hands. He's ran up. He's starting to climb the tower. He's moving slowly. He started to climb. And after him, everyone else is starting to climb up as well. Who's going to be the fastest on the climb? It's going to be Ajax, for sure. But I think it's going to take a moment for them to get up atop. There's not going to be any kind of firing. So, everybody makes it to the top. When they kind of going to get up to the top, there's two goblins waiting for them. The goblins have the initiative as everyone kind of climbs up on them. The goblins have gotten off the cannon, have drawn their dirty little short swords. Yeah. The carnivore's there first. How's he gonna? The carnivore makes it to the top first. The halfling, he's at the top. There's two goblins waiting for him. They both attack. The first goblin attacks with an 11. 10 misses. The halfling dodges out of the way. The other goblin misses as well. The carnivore proves to be way too fast for these guys. Now it's up to carnivore. Back to the top of the list. Carnivore's just got a club. We always thought halflings are good at double-handed. Halflings, so in Dungeon Crawl Classics, halfling is a class, just like old school D&D. Elf is a class, dwarf is a class, and halflings are actually classes. So you don't see a halfling warrior or halfling rogue or anything like that. Halfling is a halfling. And they're good at double hand fighting. But for some reason, the carnivore only has a club. He rolls a 19, which is dangerously close to a natural crit. But anyway, he definitely hits one of the goblins with his club. He's doing 1d4 plus 2 points of damage. 4 plus 2. Conk. He totally knocks the heck out of one of them. He's down. One of the goblins is down. Crowd goes nuts. Woo! Right after him, Ajax had come up. Yep. Ajax is up in the scene. Ajax whips out one of his flails. Well, not one of his flails. He has several javelins. He's only got one flail. 8 plus 2 is 10. Armor class is... the goblin dodges out of the way. Actually, now that one of the goblins is done, we got to see what they... If there's a morale... We got to do our morale check on this goblin. He's sticking around. Wait. He runs. So, the halfling takes out the one. Ajax comes running at the other one to swing at his flail. He goes to swing at him. That goblin's like, screw this. He turns around, jumps off the end of the tower. The crowd goes nuts. Woo! An alarm goes off. Bing, 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 bing. The all the alarms go off. The referees call. There's a whistle. Looks like there's a short break while the players are awarded what some treasures or whatever they get for completing this first set of challenges. Players come down from the tower. The referees look like they're going to be giving them looks like a well-made a long looks like a well-made longsword in a Velcro sports scabbard. Let's see. Who wants the longsword? Oh, yeah. Well, longsword seems kind of too big for the. The halfling passes it up, even though he's just got a club. It's well made, so it looks really sharp. Ajax steps up. He goes, "I'll take it." Looks like the kind of guy who would do better with a longsword. I should have rolled a D3 for him as well. But anyway, looks like is that a set of prayer beads that they're giving to Sunburn Steelwagon? I wonder what those will do. Prayer beads. Interesting. And it looks like a scroll is being handed to one of them. Yep. Gonna give that scroll to Richard Mayday Hayden, our wizard, or just Mayday. Scroll. I wonder what it is. I guess we're gonna find out. Okay. And then what it looks like to me, folks, is a looks like they're handing a set of lock picks to Zaster Forester. I don't know why he needs. Oh, they look really nice. His eyes light up. Yeah, I can see his eyes lighting up from way up here. Or lock picks plus two, give him plus two bonus. He's already got a pretty good bonus. He's a good thief for picking locks. All right, folks. Looks like they're about ready to get going on the next section. I think we're going to go to a commercial break. This episode is sponsored by the Brotherhood. The Brotherhood of Old Gods is your friendly neighborhood cult with a modern twist. The Brotherhood meets every Tuesday to pray to the Shadowed Ones. Open house and bake sales every Wednesday. Come on down to your local chapter to meet the cultists that care. Volunteers for ritualistic sacrifices are always welcomed. Use the code EVIL to get 10% off your membership today. Thanks, folks. We're back, it looks like. Looks like the heroes are going into a tunnel of some sort. We're losing track of them, but they must be heading to that next room. And from what we can tell, the next room, there's about one, two, three, four, five. Looks about six orcs standing there staring at the door. Oh, I see. These orcs think that the characters are coming in through the door. I wonder if the referees told them that. But I wonder where the players are gonna come through. Really interesting. Gonna do a little roll here. Whoa, wait! In the middle of the room there. You see that big grate? Looks like, shh, is it moving? Yes, it's moving. And the orcs haven't even seen. The orcs are all standing, staring at the south wall, while behind them, the adventurers are coming out through the middle of the thing. There's not a sound in the stadium. No one wants to screw this up. We're all holding our breaths. Are the adventurers going to be able to get out of this underground tunnel without alerting the orcs and get a drop on them? Well, we're gonna have to see. All right. Looks like they all got out. The orcs haven't even noticed them. They're all getting edgy. The orcs are pumped up. They look like they're getting more. They know something's coming. And the players have a drop on him. Looks like a surprise attack, folks. Wait, there's only five orcs. I double counted one of them. He's a big dude. He looks like two. All right, so before we throw initiative, our players get a surprise attack on him. Ajax, with his gleaming soul. Looks like he's going to undo the Velcro on his longsword, and he thinks better of it. Grabs his flail. Click. The orcs are just turning around, realizing what's going on when the players are all up on their business, all up in their faces. All right, Ajax swings at one of the orcs. The orcs are pretty well armored, too. These aren't your run-of-the-mill, meet-them-in-the-middle-of-the-dungeon kind of orcs. These guys are beefed up and ready. They've got composite sports gear. They've got baseball hats. Looks like ultra-dark goggles on. That's probably to help them because there's no ceiling and it's all kind of bright and middle-of-the-day kind of stuff going on. Ajax swings. That's not good. Ajax swings and misses. Tina, she stayed back. She has undone her longbow, and the same with Forrester. The same with we've got a lot of archers in the team. The wizard, the elf, the thief, they're all doing that. Halfling, the carnivore's up with Ajax about to hit with his club, and along with Shalia, or I'll just call her Sunburn. Sunburn, the cleric's even got a crossbow. This is a ranged battle, people. Ranged battle. How far away are they? It's a ranged battle, but they're gonna take a little bit of a. Looks like they're all longbows, folks. So it's a little. I understand. They're moving back. They've moved back. Okay. They've moved back. Let's see. Supernova's going to go first. She's picked a target. She's getting a +3 to range. So she hits for 18. Funk. Sinks deep into one of these guys. Her longbow does 1d8 plus 1. Oh, no. Her longbow does 1d6 plus 3. 7 points of damage. I don't think this orc is going to... Nope. Right through a throat. Shlunk. Or actually, it'd be more like... crumples to the ground. Just then, Forrester lets loose his arrow. He also hits. 6. Shunk. Right in the back of the head. 2 orcs down, folks. 2 orcs down. The crowd goes nuts. We can't hold it. We can't hold it in anymore. The other orcs are turning around. It's still too late for them. Richard Mayday Hayden. I love seeing a guy in a robe take his shots with his longbow. And he misses. Stick the spells, Mayday. Stick the spells. Shing. Crossbow goes off. Sunburn also misses with a crossbow bolt. Orc turns around to see, just in time to see one go right by his head. That same one turns around just in time to see the crossbow bolt go by his head. He notices the carnivore at his knees, swinging with his club. He manages to dodge out of the way, sidesteps, and the halfling misses. Surprise is out of the way, is over. So now it's time for initiative rolling. The orcs, +1 initiative. When you roll initiative, you roll for the group. So orcs have rolled a 9. Well, rolled an 8 plus 1. Modifier is 9. Ajax, 7. Supernova, 14. Forrester is 17. Mayday is 14. 17. He's 19. Okay. Nice. And finally, sunburn is 1. Sunburn's going last. But it makes sense though, because she's got a crossbow. She's got to drop that and get her mace out and or reload it. You know, so we'll see what she decides to do. All right. What's happening? The carnivore. He goes racing across the... Oh, no, he's not racing. He's right there. He takes another swing at this guy who sidestepped him. Looks like carnivore's taking another shot with his club and misses. This orc is dancing more than Michael Jackson at a... He's dancing more than Michael said. Is he moonwalking? All right. So that was the carnivore. He misses by a long shot. Forrester. He is going to take a... He's going to reload and take another shot with his longbow. Ooh. And he misses as well. Totally misses the one that the halfling is fighting. 17... 14 is Supernova. She has also reloaded. She rolls a 17 or 18. Yes, she definitely hits one. She had hit the one next to the last one she hit. Doing 5 points of damage. She hits one and hits it so hard that it stumbles back and it looks really bad, but he's not, he hasn't fallen yet. We have three orcs left, folks. One's badly injured. One's dancing around. I'm sure the other one's going to be hurting somebody soon. And it's because it's their turn. Okay, the one that's still alive is attacking Ajax. He's attacking the big dude. And he hits. Four. Crowd goes nuts as the baseball bat connects with Ajax. 1d5. Roll 1d6. Plus 1. Alright. Dork swings. And he hits. But it looks like it's a foul ball because he didn't hit him too hard. It's enough to make Ajax stumble back a minute, but he's back in the fight. The orc that did the little dancing, he is now retaliating against the carnivore. Ooh, and he fumbles like big time. So, Dungeon Crawl Classics, you roll a 1, you fumble, you get to roll on the cool fumble table. Should I just pull up? Over here. Fumble, you trip and fall, wasting this action. You are prone and must use an action to stand next round. So the dancer, feeling too much of himself, takes a swing at the halfling. The halfling moves, and he totally falls over and is now laying on the ground, face planted. The one that's hurt, he is going to... he's running towards Tina. But he's not going to make it in time. So he's heading towards Tina. He wants to take out the ranged guys. And now it is... That was all three of the orcs. So now it is Ajax. Ajax swings at the guy who just hit him. Ajax gets plus 2. It's 14. And totally misses. Totally. The orc dodges out of the way. This is a... good equal fight here, folks. Then who's left? What was Sunburn? Oh no, the mage. Mayday Hayden. Looks like he's reloaded his arrow, his longbow. He takes another shot. He rolls a 6 and wastes yet another arrow. And finally, looks like Sunburn's reloaded her crossbow to take a shot at the one that's fighting with Ajax and misses. I think it's time they join the melee. What do you think, folks? We're now back to the top of the list. Carnivore. Is he finally tired of this? Oh, wait. So the guy's prone. That means he gets a extra, he gets to move a die up there. DCC, Dungeon Crawl Classics, has this kind of cool function called the dice chain, where depending on the situation, you might move up or down the dice chain. What that means is instead of rolling a d20 to hit this guy, he's moving he because this guy's prone, he's face planted on the ground. He gets to roll d24, which if you go to the website for goodmangames.com, you can buy these dice that actually roll d24s, d3s, d7s, that kind of thing. They're all these weird shapes. Or for a d24, it's roll 1d12 and a 1d6. So. Rolls off 15. He hits this guy on the ground. So. So our halfling friend just bashes him in the back of the head. Doing. Yeah. So he hits him pretty good, but the guy looks like he's groggily trying to stand up or get up. So he isn't out completely, but he hit him pretty good. So finally. We are not finally, but now it is Zaster or Forrester, our thief. He's decided to put away. He sees the guy running towards. He's wounded, but the guy who's running towards Supernova. So he drops the longbow and he runs up to him. He's only like 20 feet away, with his draws a short sword. He's got his short sword ready. We'll see. And goes to swing, but the orc is a little more with it than he originally assumed, and kind of does a turn and jukes him. Does a juke. Forster fails on his roll. Now we've got Supernova. Supernova, Tina. Yeah, she's not about to be like she drops the longbow, draws her longsword, and rushes up to hit this guy too. I don't think drawing a weapon is an action. I think it just counts. It's like a free action. So the way combat works in Dungeon Crawl Classics is you get, depending on your level, you'll get one move and one action. And then as you get higher level, you might get multiple actions. When, but I'm pretty sure drawing a weapon isn't an action. I might be wrong, but who cares? We're having fun, right? So this guy is like. All right, so this guy is way more together than it appears. He's a pretty skilled dude. It's a good thing they've already knocked him down pretty good with his with her arrow, because he might have been a real challenge. So she misses, Forster misses. We are at the orc's turn. It's his turn. She's the last one to have tried to hit him. He takes a swing with his baseball bat. He swings for the stands. Oh my gosh, he connects. Tina, Supernova Gosling, is the baseball in this analogy. Is she hit out of the park? Let's see. One D five. He's rolling a 1d5. I think that's just re-roll 1d6 and then don't. Don't count. Are you rolling? No, it's not that. It's probably D5 is. Yeah, 1d10 divided by 2. Okay. Orc swings and hits for 4. 4 damage, folks. She is hurting. That, we all go, oh! Because we heard it in the stands. Thunk. She crumples over. Ugh. She's not done. She's not out, but she is hurting. What do we have left? Oh, we got the guy who's prone. The guy who's prone, carnivore hit in the back of the head. He manages to get up. That's his whole action of the round. He's managed to get up. He's woozy, but he is back in the fight if he lasts another round. And then finally, the one that's fighting Ajax takes a swing at Ajax. Oh, he hits 19. He swings. And he hits for four. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, he hits bad. We hear the ringing against Ajax's armor. I think Ajax is wearing like a leather. And it rings like it's chain. That's how hard it got hit. Bong! Ajax is not looking good, people. All right, those are the orcs. Back up the carnivore. Will he finish off this dazed orc? The carnivore crits. All right, so Dungeon Crawl Classics as well. You get to, if you roll a crit, you get to roll on the crit table. On a crit table, depending on what class you are. That's fun. Rolling on tables is fun. Let's see. All right, cool. You get to roll on this table. We're going to roll and see what happens. He rolls an 18. Blow hammers. Oh. The blow hammers shards of bone into the foe's forebrain. Gray matter oozes out. Inflict plus 1d to 8 damage with this strike, and the foe suffers 1d4 points of intelligence and personality loss. I don't think that matters because I think this sucker's dead. Yeah. So the orc is up. He wants to try to swing, and the carnivore with this awesome leap leaps up and just smacks him so hard in the head, we swear we see brain go flying. And the orc goes on the ground. We go nuts. Woo! We are liking the carnivore, friends. The carnivore is a cool dude. Next up, we have Forrester. Looks like Forrester is taking charge. The one that hit Tina, he is enraged. If the white-haired devil could even be enraged, he swings his short sword. Maybe he should have stuck to. Man, he should probably stick to. I wonder if he could backstab. I wonder if we get around to backstabbing. He's going to attempt to backstab. We're going to rewind just a quick second because thieves can backstab. And it seems like if that orc had focused on Supernova and it hurt her. He might be not necessarily paying attention, and part of Forrester's move is he could move himself around, but does it have to be, they have to be not aware of the threat. So that makes sense. So Forrester takes a swing, and the orc easily parries him. Ching. The orc's taking care of two of them. Now we see why the orc just said screw it and started running at the ranged guys, because he can obviously take care of himself. So that was Forrester. Okay, Supernova. She's hurt. What is she going to do? Yes. She's going to swing again with her longsword. You think that maybe she'd take a shot with her spells, but maybe she doesn't think she has enough time. Maybe she feels like kind of pressured. She's got to fight. Get out of there now. She swings. And she misses. It's not looking good for Supernova. Maybe she should have went for the spell book. We're going to see how that works out for her. We are at the orcs. All right. The orc that's fighting Tina and Forrester, he sees the last swing that Tina did at him was so weak that he doesn't feel that she's so much of a threat as much as Forrester is. So he turns his attention to Forrester and swings for the stands. And Forrester easily dodges out of the way. Forrester's not the easiest target. The other orc that's fighting Ajax, he goes in for the kill. He wants to take Ajax out. Ajax is hurting. We might see our first death today, folks. And it might be the guy who's probably been training his whole life for this situation. Let's see what happens. And the orc misses. Ajax moves out of the way at the right moment. We go nuts. Yes! yes, 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 he's still in the fight. That was the two orcs. Then we're back to the top of the list, the carnivore. He looks around, he sees that melee and Ajax is in melee in a bad way with one of the orcs. So he runs up to the one orc and swings at his legs, trying to take out his knees, and misses. Trying to decide if he wants to spend some luck, but he's not going to. And he misses. The orc sees him coming and moves his knee just at the right time. Next up, we have, oh boy, we got Forrester. Forrester, he needs to take this guy out. What kind of trickery does he have? Not much. Not much. He's gonna swing with his longbow. We are rolling terrible now. Swings with his longbow. Yeah, he swings with his longbow. No, he swings with his short sword, and the orc parries. Then Tina. I think Tina has finally decided that she's got to do something else. She moves. She's going to try moving away, and you see she holds up her hands. You see her lips move. She's casting something, friends. She rolls a 20. All right. So every time you cast a spell in Dungeon Crawl Classics, you consult a chart. And when you make the check, depending on what you roll, different things can happen. So we're going to see what those different things are right now. We don't know what she casts, folks, but we're about to find out. Okay. First, she made a check. So we're going to roll that. Suddenly, we see a yellowish force field expand in front of her. Yeah. So, she speaks the words. We see the thing. All of a sudden, this yellowish force field pops up in between her and the other orc. Looks like she's casted a magic shield, folks. Smart. And much needed. Next up is the orcs. That orc sees the shield come up. He understands what it is. He's still focused on Forrester. They've now become a little bit of a duel. You see his eyes narrow. It's him versus the thief. That's a crit, and the monsters get the crit too. Yeah, so they get the roll on the crit table as well. We're gonna see what happens. Of course, that means going through the book to find the crit table. There we go. Okay. One. I think that's good. Opportunistic strike. I think I'm pretty sure there's a crit table for monsters. Maybe that's in the, yeah, you know what? It's in the appendixes. I'm gonna pull that out because I want to make sure I give these guys the best shot they got. And isn't it fun to go through the appendix if it's there? All right, opportunistic strike. So the orc, the shield comes up over here. He's not even paying attention to Tina anymore. He narrows his eyes. He's got a kind of a good idea. This guy has been around quite a bit. He's turned out to be a much better opponent than we thought in the beginning. He looks like he's sizing Zaster up. Zaster dances. He dances in. He's gonna go in for another hit. And the orc notices. Like it's like he read his mind. He knew exactly where Zaster was gonna go because he lashes out right at the last moment, does some extra damage. He's 1d5 plus 1d3. So where's my d10? So that's three, and well, it's 1d3. So wait, hold on, my bad. You're lucky. Ooh, very lucky. Ooh, in a good way. So Zester zigs, zags, almost like he played right into it. The orc lashes out with the bat. Instead of swinging this time, he goes out in a way that you couldn't telegraph it and knocks Zester right in the face. Bust, looks like he busted his nose. That pretty white hair and that blood going everywhere, I'd say it's kind of like a work of art. Then the one that's fighting Ajax. So that carnivore has joined the fray, but Hank Ajax is still the scarier target to him. So and he's all and Ajax is almost out, so this orc looks like he wants to finish the job. We might see our last a last if it bounces out of the box, it don't count. Oh, crit. Okay, all right, we got a crit, another crit. Ajax might be going down now. Seven. Smash foe's hand, inflict 2d3 damage with his strike, and break two of his fingers. Seven, yeah. Hold on, I need to find. Where did I put that other book? All right, so Ajax ain't gonna. He's gonna be going down for the count. But he's not gonna be dead. He's gonna be bleeding out. He's got a few rounds before that happens. But we'll roll the damage anyway to see how it works out. It's actually one, five. Yeah, okay. So he swings, mighty swing. Ajax holds up his hand to try to block it. Smashes into his hand, smashes into his head. He goes, Ajax falls to his knees. The crowd goes quiet with a gasp. We thought it was going to be okay. We thought it was going to be okay. And Ajax falls to the ground. Now, folks, that doesn't mean he's out. That doesn't mean he's out at all. We know he's got a healing potion. They all got healing potions. Someone's just got to get to him to stop the bleeding in time. Is Sunburn close enough? Yes, she is. We're going to see how that rolls out. We now move to, it would have been Ajax's turn, but he is down. And now we're moving to Mayday. What are you going to do, Mayday? Mayday, looks like he's notching. Is he going to notch another arrow? Or is he going to. Looks like Mayday, looks like he's pulling out the scroll that he got from the other realm. He's pulling it out. He's reading aloud. 20. Sweet. We don't even know who he's aiming at. What's he even doing with this scroll? What was this scroll? Where was that scroll? Okay. First off, he made it with a 20. We're gonna roll. So another cool thing about spells is that they can manifest differently. In the beginning, if you're successful, you roll to see how it manifests. And he reads from the scroll, and this bluish, glowing, looks like an axe, folks, comes flying out of the scroll, flipping over, and slams into the orc that is fighting Forrester and Tina. Sh-bam! It's almost we can hear it. Sh-bam! And let's see his yeah. Oh wow! Hold on, it's not just one. It's not just one, which is pretty sweet. Four of these. all slamming into. Oh. Ooh. Can be separate targets. So, he rolled 20. I consult the chart. The chart tells me the intensity of the spell and what can do. Right now, he can throw 1d4 plus 2 missiles. That's 4 missiles. It's magic missile, but it's manifesting as these glowing axes. He's going to do 4. He's throwing 2 at the orc, the 2 at the 2 separate orcs. He's splitting them up. 2 go bam and 2 go bam. They never miss, and they're doing 1d6 plus the level of the caster. So the two that are going for the two that are the guy that's fighting Forrester and Tina, four, five, three, yep. And the other one is 4, 5, 6, 7. These axes fly in, boom, 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 and then the other orc that's fighting that just took out Ajax, boom, boom, boom. These orcs are out. It is over. We erupt in battle. That was crazy. Why didn't you pull that scroll out in the beginning, man? Even Mayday himself looks a little stunned. I'm telling you, folks, we're probably gonna see that scroll happen, pull out, getting pulled out again later. But for now, Sunburn runs up to administer help to Ajax. The referees call whistles. People run out to start like the just. The help comes running out to start dragging the orc bodies off the thing. And it looks like they've made it through. Right. Yes, looks like they made it past the orcs. The referees blow the whistle and they come rushing out. Sunburn runs up to Hank, and it looks like she's going to perform healing on lay on hands to him. A cool thing about clerics in Dungeon Crawl Classic is their healing isn't counted as a spell. It's counted as a feature of the class. You get lay on hands. You still have to do a spell check with it, and there's this cool mechanic where if you're your alignment comes into play. You get your best heals if you're healing somebody who is the same alignment as you. But if they happen to be like a direct opposite, like law to chaos, then you can get disfavor from your deity, and that can cause you problems and casting your stuff. She does not have that problem. She is definitely casting. He gets his hit die in healing. 3 plus 1d4. So he is Sunburns goes, you see him doing it. Everyone, there's a breath of relief. We cheer because Hank is back in the game. Hank is back. Okay, we got Hank back. Looks like the carnivore is accepting the treasure from the oh yeah. So, it looks like Tina. She's not drinking a potion. Except that a potion, she's drinking it now. Her head, that's 1d6, 1d4. She's looking a lot better now. Tina's back up to snuff. She's already drank her potion. Looks like Carnivore's accepting another potion of healing. From the and it looks like a note of some sort. I've been told that they're for winning this room, they get 500 gold pieces. They'll be able to divvy up later, and I believe there's a gift certificate for Starbreak Importers, well, another one of our sponsors. They'll be able to pick up some sweet equipment if they get out of here alive. All right, let's go to a commercial break. Big Buck is the best stable master in the kingdom. Can you walk? Do your feet hurt? Timed quests getting you down? Come on down to Big Buck Stable, offering new, used, and refurbished mounts. We have it all here. We take good credit, bad credit, no credit. Big Buck says, no credit, no problem. So what are you waiting for? Call now. All right, guys, we're back. It looks like everybody is getting the best they can to get healed back up and getting back on the road. Yes, yes. All right, it looks like because we can kind of see ahead, it looks like this next challenge is going to be a little bit of a doozy. Because from this angle, it looks like a pit trap, and there's something moving around down inside there. So we're gonna have to see how the team gets past this. A door opens at the other end of the room where the orcs were in, and the players start heading down through there. Ajax, Supernova, Forester, Mayday, Carnivore, and Sunburn in that order start heading down this corridor. The corridor looks like it's thick plexiglass. As they go down straight, they turn left around a corner, and they see that it looks like a 10-foot deep and 20-foot long pit. Inside are several scampering creatures, each the size of a small horse. They have long antennae that I can see, and I'm being told they have tough-looking hide. They're skittering about trying to leap out of the pit to get to Adam. The pit takes up the entire corridor, and there is no ledge. And I'm being told that they are rust monsters. Not good. Looks like the team is taking a break to talk to each other about what to do. Soup scheming is back and forth. Looks like Forrester's reaching into his pack and pulling out some rope. And looks like he's got a grappling hook. They're nodding. Everyone's nodding. It looks like Mayday's he's waving it around his hands. Everybody says okay. And they're all standing back from him. Looks like he might be attempting to cast a spell. All right. 15. He gets a modifier plus 2. Was that a crack of thunder? We look up. The sky is all blue. No clouds in sight, but we just heard a crack of thunder. Did that come from Mayday? Most surely it did. What is he attempting to do? Holy crap. Four, it just looks like spider limbs are growing, sprouting from his torso. Is he gonna crawl across the wall? He rolled a 15. It looks like that's what he's about to do. And, sure enough, he's taking, Zaster hands him the grappling hook, attached the rope, and looks like Mayday is crawling across the wall over to the other side. He makes it in no time. Crowd goes nuts. It looks like he's attaching the grappling hook the best he can on the other side. There's a door on the other side. And now everyone's got to shimmy across the rope without falling into the pit. Everybody's got to have a chance to do this. And there is a big cost if they fail. So we're going to roll for everybody. Looks like Ajax is going to go across first. We're going to use his agility modifier. He makes it. Yay! Meanwhile, the rust monsters are running up the side of the pit trying to get at him. Next up, Tina. Makes it across, no problem. Forrester decides to walk across it, not a problem. The halfling, Carnivore, no problem. He just runs right across. And finally, the cleric. We're a little worried about the cleric. She's not going to go walking across. She's going to have to climb across. And she's wearing some armor, and she's got a mace. I mean, this is dinner walking across. I mean, if these rust monsters can suddenly figure out how to jump even higher, she's in trouble. Oh, she barely makes it. Barely makes it across. Grr, shakes it slow. She gets across. They're all across the pit. Ooh. All right. What awaits them in the next room? Doesn't look like the room is locked. And they open the door slowly. And now this is the room that has. It's not a huge room. Maybe 30 foot by 30 foot, but it's like empty and it looks like it's covered in sand. There's another door heading out in the north. They just came in from the east. And as they come in, none of us really know what's going to happen in this room. Is there something hiding in the dirt? Or is something going to drop out of the sky again? Well, I guess we're just going to have to wait and see. The players kind of shuffle in. They're standing near the door, kind of looking around, trying to figure out what's going to happen here. And then that's when, that's when Tina goes, "Wait, look out!" And that's when we notice that there's footprints. Some kind of footprints in the sand. Whatever's in there is either super camouflaged for sand or invisible. And it's coming right at them. There wasn't a surprise because Tina knows this, so we're gonna roll initiative. And invisible thing. Invisible thing is a five, is an eight. Ajax, one. Wow. Oh, he's got a three. Supernova. Ooh, rolling bad today. She's a four. Forester. He's rolling six, eight. Wow, he's. Mayday. 18. Good for you, Mayday. The carnivore. Well, he's 13. And Sunburn. She comes in at a 4. All right. Richard, Mayday, springs into action first. He's a smart guy. He understands that if, we can't see him. You can still cast something at him. Is he getting out the scroll again? I think he is. It's an auto hit. Why would you not? He's pulling out the scroll. Crowd goes nuts. What's it going to be this time? It doesn't matter. I would love to see those force axes again. That'd be pretty sweet. He rolls his spell check. Rolls a 9, 10, 11. What happens? Is that no? That might not even be. He might not even. Okay. So, yes. 11. 12 is actually, 11 is a failure. 12 will make it. This is a point where the character can decide, or the player can decide to spend a point of luck to add one to the die, and he'll permanently lose that luck. However, he's got a halfling in the game. The halfling can spend his luck to help other people, and he regens his luck. Well, once a night, he won't get it back now, but he does get it back. Whereas Mayday would actually lose it. So our Lucky Charm halfling is going to spend one luck. And add one to that roll so it's a success. So the scroll's gonna fire off. What, how it's gonna fire off? How it's gonna fire off. This time, this time it's an arrow. It's a glowing arrow. It's a missile that goes right at and strikes this whatever it is invisible. But it didn't look that powerful. And it wasn't. It was actually kind of embarrassing. So I don't know if that was worth spending the luck point or not. But yeah, it wasn't. Okay. That was May Day. Next up, it's pretty big. Oh, it's the carnivore. So, the halfling, I think what the carnivore is going to do, he doesn't know what he's hitting. He's a small guy though, but he's going to scoop up and throw as much sand as he can at this invisible thing. He does that, and sand clutters over top of a lot of things. So whatever this is, it's very big. And he can't tell exactly what it is, but whatever he went over was like, it looks like it's an appendage of this thing. That's all. We none of us know what this thing is. And now that we're looking, we notice that, there's a lot of feet. A lot of feet. So the carnivore spends his action doing that. What he does accomplish is, you know what? Let's roll. Let's roll to see how well he accomplishes this. Okay. He does enough dirt. We can't tell what it is. It's big though. It's massive. But what it does accomplish is there's enough sand on there to give everybody a target. So next up in the fight is going to be Forrester. Yes. It's broad daylight, man. There are no shadows in here. He can't be hiding. He can shoot though. He's notching an arrow. He's taking a shot right where he can see. 18. He scores a hit. Schlunk. He hears it. He hears it go through shell? Sounded like it went through shell or something. Whatever it was is harder than flesh. He's doing 1d6 plus 2. 6 points of damage. So whatever it is, he hits. They see the arrow sticking in. That's another cool thing, is now the arrow sticking in, and you can see the arrow. It's just hanging in air. Half of it's missing, right? And whatever it is, the arrow goes up. We all hear like a, we go, what? Whoa! No, nobody knows what's going on now. Who's up next? The invisible monster. The invisible monster. The whatever part has the arrow when it kind of goes up, and suddenly, let's see, who would be closest to this thing? It turns. The thing has turned to the source of wherever the pain came from, and let's see what happens. Or let's not see what happens. Ooh, it rolled a 1. How does something like this fumble? I do not know. Let's see. Oh no. 16. You accidentally strike yourself for normal damage plus an extra 1 point. In addition, you fall on your back and you're unable to right yourself until you make a DC 16 agility check. Okay. So whatever this thing is, it goes to strike him. It gets tangled up in its own body, and kind of falls down a bit. And let's see, it's doing its own damage to itself. Plus 1. actually no. Yes, yeah, that is what happens. It does try to strike itself. So it's going to be doing 1d4 plus 3. 1d4 plus 3 plus 1 is 8 points of damage. What just happened? Suddenly, coming into view, just appears out of nowhere, is this gigantic blue scorpion with its own stinger stuck in its head, and it collapses on the ground, and it's very dead. Death by stinger. We managed to have the blue giant blue scorpion kill itself accidentally. Crowd goes crazy. That's never been, has this ever been seen in a dungeon crawl up until now? This might be the first time this has ever been seen, folks, and you are here to witness it with me, the Lich, your host. It takes everybody a minute, even the refs, to really digest what just happened. But the whistle's blown, and doesn't look like it looks like nobody gets treasure for this room, which is kind of crazy because that's a pretty that would have been a pretty tough room, right? With everything that was going on, but our heroes handled it beautifully. And I think we're gonna take a break here, and catch back up next Saturday for to finish this out to see how this ends. And see how our heroes survive. Thanks for tuning in. If we didn't have much chat room tonight, if you get a chance, chat it up. Let me know what the heroes should be doing, that kind of thing. Join me on Friday. On Friday nights, I'm doing a full campaign in Dungeon Crawl Classic, starting with a funnel, which means I've got a group of zero level peasants that I'm taking through. A classic Dungeon Crawl Classics adventure called Sailors on a Starless Sea. And we're kind of working through, taking input from chat, like all play together, and seeing where we take these guys and whoever lives. The way Dungeon Crawl Classics got this cool thing called the funnel, where you take zero level characters and you run them through. Everybody has like three or four characters each, and you run them through an adventure, and whoever lives, lives, and goes on to be first level. And whoever doesn't, doesn't. And then you take those first level characters, you run them, and the system can be really brutal at times, but can also be pretty fun. Really fun because of the brutality, I mean. So check me out on Fridays. You can check out a recap of the first session and then the full second session on the in the video section. And then there'll be a recap of this, or actually, I'll be recorded. There'll be this is getting recorded and put up too. So be able to check this out. And yeah, thanks for joining. FIFA Dungeon.